It's a free for all. Baby. Yeah, it's free for all.
What is up, freebies? Welcome to episode 17 of the free for all. Today, February 28th, 2024. If you're watching us on camera, you know we look a little different. What is going on here?
We're better looking.
Yeah, I'm confused. I don't know what's going on.
Yeah,
you're on my right. We got a new guy over here, and where is Chad? I can hear him, but I can't see him.
I am in Sugarland, Texas.
What's going on in Sugarland, Chad?
We're at the TSPRA School for Public Relations Conference.
Oh, that sounds like a blast.
It does sound like a lot of fun. I'm just thrown off, Chad. Okay, I've learned a lot of things in the first minute of this show. There is a thing here that you've been hiding from me that has buttons that I can press and sounds come out. And now I am now in charge of that today. I want everybody to know that.
MJ is now in charge of sound effects.
Yeah, MJ is now on my right. And I can't read the rundown because he keeps it at like tiny, the tiniest font ever. And you're not here to so that I can read it off of your screen. And Chris is over here and
I'm just like, hey, man, what's happening?
Yeah, I don't know what to do with Chris.
I'm like, we have a rundown? What's that?
Yeah, we do. When we used to do my pregame show, we had no rundown. We'd look up 45 minutes later. We hadn't talked about the game or anything relevant to football. So this show could go totally off the rails real quick.
So do you want to test out one of those buttons real quick?
Yeah, what do I have to press here?
Drum roll, please.
There it is.
Love it.
So those are the sound effects that we have at our disposal. So if you hear things randomly throughout that podcast, that is Grant just getting antsy and pressing buttons. Hopefully that doesn't happen too often.
Hopefully that doesn't cause a chasm.
Speaking of chasm, that's my new Wordle word every day until it gets
chasm's
to be the
a
word.
Good one.
Yeah. You know how to spell chasm?
I like you soaping the show, calling everybody freebies, too.
Yeah, that's not
freebies
bad, huh?
Freebies is good, too, yeah.
Yep, stole that from social media. I believe I saw that.
That was Macaulay, wasn't it?
Macaulay came up with the whole freebie, and then Britt Milstead, who I work with over at KFDX, said we should be the freebie fan club. It's a little bit of a tongue twister.
FFC.
It's like Swifties, but cooler.
It's exactly
yeah,
right.
A lot cooler.
And Macaulay now wants advertising time.
That's great. Macaulay Landscaping, they'll mow your grass.
Yeah, we got to work on our ad reads. I was thinking about that. That's here on the rundown at the top. Macaulay Landscape, what is it? Mowing, irrigation, and landscape.
Stuff.
I drove by the other day and saw him working in a yard, and, I mean, all I could see was about waist up. He was that far down in a hole doing something.
Digging, building, you name it. Yeah. So, yeah, we got to work on our ad reads, but thanks, Patrick Macaulay. Anyway, some introductions because we're now blabbering 3.5 minutes into this thing. I'm MJ, as always. This is Coach Free, as always. Chad on the phone, as always. But you may be asking yourself, who's this guy down on the end? We've never seen that guy before. Mm. Well, you should. He's the sports director at KUZ Channel 6 here in Wichita Falls. Chris Cutter, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, MJ. Thank you, Free.
Are you excited?
Yes, of course I'm excited.
Okay.
Kidding me?
That's good.
I was actually waiting for this call for like the last, 4 months?
Okay.
Something
yeah.
like that, 17 episodes.
Correct.
Look at how fancy yeah. we are. We have a studio. We
this
have
isn't quite the
microphones.
Desk on Avenue H.
Yeah, we have no, it's not Coach Free's desk at Old High.
The last 7 years or
yeah,
whatever.
Yeah. So
we've
hey, definitely Grant, upgraded.
Grant, you're going to have to be the mediator, battle of the network stars there.
You know, here's the thing. I'm still just thrown off. MJ being on my right has really got me screwed up. I'm just letting y'all know. Like, I am a creature of habit, and this has really thrown me off.
Well, to be honest with you, Chad, I thought I was going to have to do some switching today and dealing with audio with you being on the phone, but we just get to sit back and do it as if it was normal, so I could have sat on the left.
Yeah.
Thanks for making our life easy. Appreciate it.
Yeah, it's awesome.
See, we're still working on this trying not to talk over each other thing.
I know.
So
Chad being on the phone's got us all screwed
it's tough.
Up.
It's tough. So anyway, Chad, we do want to start with you, though, because we're starting with local basketball here, specifically girls' stuff. And I know the first weekend of two in a row at the K. Agri Coliseum was busy for you. You had the girls' 5A regional tournament. Ultimately, it's Mansfield Timberview who's advancing to state. What can you tell us about the weekend that was at the KYC?
Man, and Grant can attest to this. If we can mimic this weekend what we had last weekend, people are in for a treat. They need to get out and watch. First game we had Amarillo and Mansfield Timberview. And I'm here to tell you, I think Amarillo was the best team that was there. Timberview was a lot more athletic, full of a lot more athletes, but just as far as team goes, Amarillo, man, they were tough. They lost in overtime. Timberview beat them in overtime, and then game two, Argyle and my mind went blank. Robert Cooper.
Tascosa,
yes, I'm sorry. Double overtime. So two incredible, incredible games. Timberview, man, there's a reason they've only lost one game. They find a way to get it done at the end, but what a great weekend of basketball.
And then you kind of – let's look ahead a little bit to the boys while we're on that. I got the four teams here in front of me. It's going to be Amarillo High against Mansfield Summit in one regional semifinal, and then El Paso Chapin and Colleyville Heritage in the other semifinal. And if my math is correct, three of these teams were actually here in Wichita Falls last year, Amarillo, correct, Summit, and Chapin. So we can expect some more rematches, I guess, if you will.
Chapin and Summit were the final last year. Chapin and Amarillo have been here each of the 3 years we've hosted. In fact, Amarillo boys and girls, I guess now five of the six regional tournaments we've hosted, we've had Amarillo High School at. So
how about that?
Should be some great basketball.
Grant, your thoughts on girls and boys?
Yeah, you know, going back to the girls game, as you get to this point or you're playing for a spot to go to state, that's what you want. You want evenly matched teams. And what was really unique to me when we were all out at and kind of watching that tournament is it was a total contrast of styles in the games. Mansfield Timberview was just so athletic, played that suffocating defense, got a lot of their points in the paint. Amarillo High and Argyle as well was more of your traditional pass, set the ball up, skill-based, shoot at a high clip, and it just turned out to, you know, over a two-day span, Timberview just suffocated both of them. They played in tough games. They made shots when they had to, but, you know, again, the athleticism kind of won out, and they're going to be a tough out. They're going to be a tough out in San Antonio. I really do think that they could be the state champion in 5A, and we'll see what they do when they get to San Antonio this weekend. But man, it was a lot of fun. Chad and I got to break up a fight between coaches.
Whoa.
It was lots of high drama at Kay Yeager last weekend.
I heard
that. Saturday was definitely a tale of two halves. We talked a little bit about that in other sports, but you know, Argyle kind of dictated the pace, took the air out of the ball the first half. I think it was 11-10 at the half.
Yeah.
But Timberview definitely dictated the pace the second half, and once they were able to kind of get moving and controlling the floor and get running, they were able to kind of pull away a little bit.
I heard about these girls' games, but I actually was not there. I was traveling to other local games down in Mansfield and McKinney. Chris, were you at these games or no?
Yeah, actually I was. That Amarillo Mansfield game was fantastic. I mm-hmm. really thought that, like Chad said, Amarillo felt like the better team, okay, just on the court, the feel of it. They made a few mistakes down the way. I mean, there was a young lady that had a wide-open shot with less than a minute to go. And I really thought, oh, she's going to pull the trigger, but she didn't. It ends up being a turnover later on in the play, and that's the bucket that Timberview ends up going ahead on in overtime. So it's one of those that it was a fantastic game, and may I take a quick second for anybody local listening. If you don't come out, even though there's not a Wichita Falls team or a local team here, it's a fantastic setup. I mean, this is rivals anything down in the Metroplex. Mm-hmm. The way that the setup is at Kay Yeager Coliseum is great. The atmosphere is electric. It's a great time. So come out and buy tickets, even if you don't necessarily have a dog that you're rooting for in this game. It's a great time. It's great basketball.
And just for context as well, this is some of your better teams in the state. Not just in the region.
Right.
You know, Mansfield Timberview last week was 1. I believe Amarillo High was 3. Mm-hmm. Argyle was 12 in the state. And Tascosa was right there. Went to double overtime with Argyle. They looked outstanding. And then, again, this weekend, you've got some of your better teams in the state. Obviously in the region, but in the state. So you could potentially see a state champion and or, I'm telling you right now, in any other given year, Amarillo High wins state championship girls, and they get knocked out in the regional semi.
It's crazy.
Wow.
I'll tell you one thing I've noticed the last few years, you know, there's a definite brand of basketball in West Texas, boys or girls. They play a lot more physical brand of basketball than some of the DFW schools, and I think that kind of neutralizes some of the athleticism a little bit that some of these DFW schools have.
We had, obviously, and Chris probably goes through this as well, we've got affiliate stations throughout the state of Texas, and with the tournament being here in Wichita Falls, they like to ask us if we can shoot it for them to save them travel, and that's usually the time when I get to see these other teams, even though I didn't last week, and actually I won't this week as well, because I'll be in San Antonio, but the point being, you know, when these quote-unquote West Texas branded teams come, I do agree with Chad. You see some things that we don't see, I guess, during the normal year that I find interesting just as a sports fan.
Yeah, for sure. And you'll see that again this weekend with boys. It's very contrasting styles. I'll tell you, looking at the games last night, the regional quarterfinals to come to the regional tournament, the Colleyville Heritage Brewer game was a one-point game, low scoring. I believe Chapin played Amarillo Paladuro. The final score of a boys' game was 30-29.
Crazy.
30-29.
Yeah.
For context, my senior year in high school, I averaged 27 points a game.
For average, Grayson Rigdon Benjamin is averaging 40-something points
a game. Yeah, yeah.
47
like,
almost, yeah.
30-29 to get there, one-point game. So it's going to be a very just contrasting styles as they get here. On the other side of that, Amarillo High was up in the 80s, you know, Mansfield Summit, very athletic, do different things. So it's really unique to see what style rides itself out or wins out.
The last WFISD basketball team still playing, I guess permanently, right, because we're doing this change, ended its season last night. It was the Hershey Huskies. They're a team that I can see sometimes, you know, locking it down on D, playing those low-scoring games. But just moving on to the next thing as far as Hershey goes, wrapping up the WFISD basketball slate. I'd love to hear from all three of us, and Grant, we'll start with you as the athletic director. Hershey Old High and Rider basketball officially no longer. Thoughts?
Yeah, it's, you know, again, as we close out sports in this year that we're closing things out, you kind of reminisce and you think back and you think about basketball and the imprint that Wichita Falls ISD and the teams made on just the state, the region, and how they did. And you think about all of what Hershey's done over the last few years in boys basketball and going back and you know, so proud of how they played and represented their school in the last season. But even before that, they've put people into college. They've done great jobs. They played basically, they were the public, we say this and we'll continue to say it, they were the public school state champions a year ago and
absolutely
going back. But even that, I go back to thinking about the things that Larry Menifee did in the 90s with those old high teams and just how good they were and how they played, the style in which they played. Riders had some outstanding teams with Cliff McGuire recently and the regional tournament teams that he's had. And, you know, you look on the girls' side and the same thing implies. We were a marker for the state and especially in this region and how we played basketball, what we put on the floor and how we did those things. And while this chapter is closing, you hope that we will again establish ourselves as a regional flagship school, kind of like what you see with Amarillo High right now, but as a flagship school to basically kind of run this region with just some new branding and some new colors.
Chad, how about your take on all that with what's going on with the last team ending its season?
You know, I echo a lot of what Grant said. You know, people kind of forget how good those old high teams were in the late 90s, early 2000s. How good Hershey's been the last, goodness, man, what, the last decade or so. And what a cool opportunity it was for Trey Law. You know, Trey's a Hershey graduate. What a cool opportunity it was for him to get to coach this last team and to have such a great run with this last team. I know Crum was a bit of a tough out yesterday. They hung with him for the better part of, what, 3.5 quarters?
Yeah.
But as Grant said, man, I'm excited to see what these school, what these coaches and kids do. A lot of these Hershey kids are going to be bumping up classifications. But, I mean, I put their talent with anybody. So it's going to be fun. It's sad to see these chapters ending, but it's fun and exciting to see the next chapters coming along.
Most definitely. And Chris, what about you? What do you think?
Well, first of all, let's talk about the Hershey Huskies again. I was there for most of the game last night. Okay. And just like all y'all said, I mean, the way they went out is exactly the way you want any of your schools to go out, and that's fighting hard. And, you know, they have everything to be proud of. It's something that it's been an enjoyable experience over the last few years, like Coach said, to watch that team grow and grow and grow and just like you said, really get to that cusp of where they should have been.
Yeah.
for Wichita Falls as a high, again, want to echo this. We have been the marker for decades. It's always been kind of an era, you know, I don't say a dynasty, but an era of Kyo basketball in the 90s. You know, the Raiders in the 2000s, you know, and here with the Huskies over the last decade or so. It's been something that this area has, like, eyes across the state have to watch us. They have to watch our teams. And I don't see that changing any because, you know, even though we are, like you said, rebranding, it's the same athletes. And so we're going to be doing the same type of thing with Legacy and Memorial. So I'm excited for the future. You know, the past is great, and it's built us up to this place. Now it's our turn. It's these athletes' turn to take it and run with it and create a new chapter.
I was at
the you know, obviously football around here gets a lot of the publicity. But just think about some of the names. You know, I had the opportunity last week to do a story on Marcus Foster. I don't think there's any doubt the best basketball player to come out of Hershey. But you go back to Bingo Marriott, Bingo's sister, Jeanette, Ty Caswell, Joe Golding. I mean, there's been some pretty darn good basketball players to come out of Wichita Falls and make their mark after Wichita Falls.
Definitely. I was at the All-Sups in Stamford last night, and the cashier said to me, "Oh, you know, I see you're from Channel 3. Where's that?" I said, "Wichita Falls." And he said, "Do you have a minute? I want to ask you about the new schools." And so we chatted at the counter at All-Sups for a couple minutes just about the mascots and the consolidation and what kids are going to what school and all that. And it was just, you know, it's definitely picking up steam statewide, not just here in Wichita Falls.
We're getting there.
I got the opportunity. Grant was able to go tour the schools the other day, and I had the opportunity to see he showed me some of the video he shot of the gym at Memorial. And, man, if you can't see that stuff coming along and not get excited for what our kids are fixing to get to have, then I don't know what's wrong with you.
We're gonna have to go around the horn style with Chad. We're about to have to mute him a couple of times because we can't see his face.
Right. So difficult.
It's hard to know when he's about to talk. But
sorry, we're not being rude to each other.
No, we're not. We just can't see him. We can only hear him. So again, you got to get excited. And now as we're getting, it's always been a dream and it's been an idea, and then now it's becoming reality because you can tangibly see the schools. You can tangibly now walk through them. You can see the things going on. We've released a lot of, you know, head coaching. So you start put people in places. And, yeah, like Chad said, it's getting exciting.
It's becoming real. I mean, people, yeah. It's getting tangible. Parents and students are signing up, and they're attending meetings. Yeah. And it's becoming real. You know, I talked with Bindle and Coach Johnson recently about some things, and they're excited. They're chomping at the bit to get these boys. And now they're seeing their teams. They're already starting to work with them a little mm-hmm. bit, talking to them, speaking with them. It's becoming real, and it's going to be super exciting. It's going to come to a fever pitch come late August.
Yeah, I can't wait. I can't wait to let the public get to see all the things that I've got to see already just on the campuses and in the excitement building with the staffs and the kids. And it's going to get there. It's been a long road, and it's been an emotional road. I was even speaking to a couple of people last night at when I got back from the Hershey game at the old High Graham soccer game, and it's emotional. It's still emotional. It was emotional for me. We talked about this in the last game that I coached, the last old High football game. It's emotional. It brings out emotions in a totally way that you're not expecting.
Yeah.
But you know, again, with all that stuff, that's on one hand, and then on this other hand, there's this really good excitement, and it's balancing that out and make sure that goes forward in the right way.
And the best conversation, or the best part of this conversation, is we get to have it again at the end of spring sports.
For sure.
So we'll jump into baseball and softball here in just a second, but I do want to touch on the local Texoma basketball team still playing. I know we just talked regional tournament here, but we got some teams from here that are still playing. We'll go back to the girls. In Class 2A, Nakona Lady Indians, they have advanced to state for the first time since 1953, I believe it was.
Yep.
And I was told it used to be 6-on-6 with girls back then. So this is like, very
well, that's a lesson for me. I didn't know that.
Chad's going to have to help us on that.
Funny is, it used to be 6-on-6, but if I'm not mistaken, my mother-in-law played basketball in the 70s, and it was 3 on one side and 3 on the other, and they couldn't cross half court.
That, you know what? That rings a bell.
So okay. How do they do that? Just pass it across? Like
I guess so.
So you only had offensive players and defensive players.
It's like volleyball, but without a net.
Sure.
Right. Yeah. I've heard Coach Conrad and Winthorst talk about that in the past, too. It was a different game for sure.
Yeah.
Wow.
Let's bring it back.
Yes.
Okay. Maybe.
Nope. Let's not bring it back.
Anyway, so Nakona, they'll play in San Antonio at the Alamo Dome Friday at 10 a.m. against Wellington in the state semifinal. And if they were to win, they would play on Saturday for the state championship. Quickly, then.
Well, you guys are going, right?
I'll be there.
Yeah, we're going to race to San Antonio after this podcast is over.
Oh.
I'm going to go the back roads. Don't tell them.
Okay.
So I'm going to ask you guys, the concept of the Alamo Dome, and we've talked a little bit about this at the KYC, and Grant, you being a former basketball player, how much different is it playing at a place like the Alamo Dome with the backboards? You know, these kids are used to playing in gyms where the backboards are right up against the wall, and now you're talking about a football stadium.
It is 1,000,000% different, and it is an incredible disadvantage.
For everybody, though.
For everyone. Let me just say that again. Like, it is a 1,000,000% difference, and it is a definite disadvantage.
100%. I mean, I've been on the floor playing at UNT and the Frank Irwin Center at Austin, and it's totally different than playing at Stanford on the road in a regional or, you know, or something like that. So, but just like Coach said, everybody's got to deal with it. I think the quicker your eyes can focus and just pay attention to what you're doing. Start close and make a layup first and then work your way back out.
And that's
how much more important are those shoot-arounds for those things like
that's
that?
That's what I was going to say. That's why we give them here in the regional tournament that we host at Kay Yeager, we give them two shoot-around times. Prior to the semifinal game, we actually give them a Thursday time and a Friday morning time. Then we actually allow them to come back in Saturday morning before the final. And I don't think – and that's what the coaches were telling us this last weekend is that's not – done anywhere else,
right.
And I think that's one of the things we do. We talked about how we run a tournament and how we try to do right by the kids and by the coaches. That's one of the ways that the city helps us to run a really good tournament.
You get 30 minutes at the Alamo Dome,
correct?
The day before your game, you get a half hour.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and you better learn. You better learn the freestanding rims.
Yeah, for sure.
Interesting. You say 1,000% different. Do maybe the Region 1 folks get a little advantage because it's a smaller scale, but it's similar in the KYC?
No, it's very. This is as close. I was looking this last week as we were hosting, and we were kind of going through, and I was looking at all the different venues.
Yeah.
This one is probably the closest to the Alamo Dome. Kay Yeager is, and here's why: not because of the sides, but it's the depth behind. Exactly. So that's probably the only. This is probably the only venue in the regional tournament host sites that has the depth behind that's similar to the Alamo Dome.
Right. And for anyone who can't picture this, it's like the NBA. You're rolling out a basket and putting it on the floor, not a baseline with a wall behind it. And that changed shooting lines for shooters and things like that. And you stand at the three-point line with all this depth behind the back.
Well, that and Chad can attest to this. I think we had to, that's why we have to curtain off the vomitories. Remember that word?
Wait.
Chad, do you remember that word? That word? The vomitories. So we have to curtain those off so there's not sunlight that comes in because that also throws off the depth perception.
Well, I've never heard of that happening at a stadium before locally.
A vomitory?
No, the sun peeking in.
Yeah, that doesn't ever happen. Yeah, happens.
So that's a
certainly wouldn't
Grant
happen.
Word of the week, vomitory.
Yeah, exactly. Vomitories. Look it up. It's the correct word.
Vomitory. Okay. Word of the day.
So that explains why before the championship game when I was shooting that's precisely why I was 0-for-15 shooting the ball.
Okay. That's why. Yes.
Chad was out there. Yeah. I did shoot around a little bit before the semifinal game, but I shot everything from like 2 foot.
You got to let us know when that's happening. That is,
I should have filmed that. Yeah, I should have filmed
that. That's going to be my explanation for why I was 0-for-15. It had nothing to do with my inability to play basketball. It was all because of the depth.
Yeah,
that's correct. Sure. That's correct. While we're on it, the other local team playing down in San Antonio this week in Class 1A, the Newcastle Lady Cats, they will play Westbrook Thursday, so tomorrow. Well, today is Wednesday, whenever this gets released. They'll play Westbrook Thursday at 8:30 a.m. So good luck to Newcastle and Nakona at State. And Chris and I will be down there for our respective stations covering all the action. Yep. So that'll be a lot of fun. On the boys' side, it is the regional tournament this weekend, and we've got three local teams who have advanced. In Class 3A, it's Holiday and City View. In Class 1A, it is Benjamin. We'll start at the bottom. Benjamin Mustangs, they went to State last year. They keep rolling through the Class 1A playoffs, although I will say Knox City gave a pretty good battle last night. Benjamin got out to like a 20-point lead and then ended up only winning by 5 or 6 points. So good job, Knox City Greyhounds. And then we moved to 3A with Holiday and City View. These two teams, not only district opponents, but in the same region at the same regional tournament. They're not playing each other in the semifinal, but if they both were to win, we'd have a regional final between two local teams with a trip to state on the line, Chris. How cool would that be?
It's awesome, and it harkens back to 1995 when Wichita Falls played Burke, and we went down to the Super Pit in Denton to play them for their right to go to state. The Coyotes won. We went on, played Austin Anderson, lost that one, unfortunately. But it's fantastic. We've honestly, you know, Ernest and I have been over at Channel 6 have been circling that going, this could happen.
Yeah.
This could happen, and it will be fantastic if we can actually get to cover, you know, City View against Holiday.
How did their district slate go?
Holiday won both.
Won both,
I believe.
Yeah, Holiday is undefeated in district. I think they are 10-0, and then but they've looked like the unstoppable force. City View has found a way, week in, week out, to get the wins.
Okay.
Never discount a gritty team.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, it's been unreal.
Holiday beat City View at the very end of the second game at City View. It was like
buzzer beater.
Yeah, Keaton Bristow, maybe like 5 seconds on the clock. He pulls up from way the heck downtown and drains a three for the win. So that'll
That's
be
right. I remember that.
Yeah, that'd be something really cool if we could get that matchup. But again, they both got a win in their regional semifinal game.
Hey, let's have them win those semis. And the heck with the championship site supposed to be, Grant. Let's move them to KYC at 3 p.m. on Saturday. What do you say?
Let's go. 3 p.m.
Just override any previous
There's
scheduling.
There's an applause button
That's right.
out over
That's
there.
That's right.
You gotta hit.
Boom. Oh, yeah, I forgot I can press buttons. Oh, crap. I don't know what to.
That was bad.
That was definitely not the right button. Oh, wait.
Yeah. You could pull that off. That's what it would sound like locally.
Yeah, that's funny.
I love this producer thing.
I don't. I think that does it for basketball. Chad, anything else on the hoops world?
No, man, looking forward to it. Looking forward to hearing about some of those games. Looking forward to our games at the Coliseum this weekend. It'll be a fun time.
Fantastic. All right, let's move to some spring sports baseball news and notes throughout this week. Rider head coach Jeremy Crouch with a career milestone, his 200th career win. 110 of those have come at Rider. That puts him third in program history. Grant, that's awesome.
Man, that's great. Especially, it's great that you can hit a milestone, especially here in the last year of it, because it kind of, you know, lets you write the record books. But Jeremy's done a great job since he's taken over. A longtime assistant, I believe he was the head coach also out at Petrolia before, or some different places around locally. But they've done a good job. They've got a great team this year. We're looking forward to seeing how far they can play. But they've been out at Hoskins the last couple of weeks, and I was looking at my schedule. They're going to start district. They've got a lot of early district games here at Hoskins and at the complex, so be sure to get out and support those guys.
Chad. Well, great way for them to start the year. They went to Denton this last weekend in a tournament, finished 3-1 for him to get that 200th win. And, you know, 110 wins at Rider, that's nothing to sneeze at. I mean, when you look at who he's behind, he actually tied my coach at Rider, Steve Stone, with 110 Rider wins. Coach Stone went on, just retired last year, went on to over 560 wins. But then you're behind, you know, Kerry Hargrove, who took Rider to their first state tournament appearance. Scott Green, who's still coaching in Iowa Park, took Rider to their one state championship appearance, or state championship title at Rider. So, you know, some great names to be behind. And another thing with Jeremy, you mentioned he started at Petrolia. That's where he met his wife, Alicia, who is also a former softball coach. I believe maybe the winningest softball coach in WFISD. So there's a lot of wins in that house.
Love that.
Think they talk baseball at the kitchen table?
I don't know.
They got a bunch of kids running around. Don't they have 3 or 4?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I always see them being bat boys and stuff for the Raiders.
My question is the question from Alicia more like, why did you do that?
Exactly. Probably causes more arguments. Probably no baseball at the table.
Yeah. So Jeremy Crouch, 110 wins at Rider, 200 career. As Chad said, Kerry Hargrove and Scott Green are 1-2. Just for context, Hargrove, 216 wins at Rider. Scott Green, 181. So congratulations, Coach Crouch. Chad, real quick aside, you're an umpire for many, many years. Any good Jeremy Crouch stories you could share?
You know, Jeremy would just always, when he didn't like a call, he'd just kind of give you this, like, kind of cockeyed look. Like, he'd kind of tilt his head. Jeremy wasn't a big arguer unless he felt like he was really wrong. He really didn't say a whole lot, but you knew when he was upset with you.
He's not very vocal just in general.
Yeah, no.
He doesn't, he's a man of few words.
Yeah, I mean, and when he would get onto you, you were, I mean, you, you, you knew you either screwed up or you at least he at least really thought you screwed up because he really didn't, like I say, he really didn't say a whole lot to you.
Chad, are you getting beeped at on the highway?
Yeah, there's a delivery truck over here. He's trying to deliver me some ice cream, it looks like.
All right, just checking. Make sure you're good over.
This has been interesting on our end. I'm just letting you know, Chad. This has been wild on our end.
So, one football news and note throughout the week. We had a coaching change in the six-man world. C.J. Hance, he was the head coach at Throckmorton. He's moving over to St. Joe, taking the head coaching job for the Panthers. Hance, of course, from Throckmorton, played his high school ball there, was the coach for, I'm probably guessing here, 4 or 5 years, as long as I've been here, and had good teams with Throckmorton, but making the move over to St. Joe. Mark Stevens had just retired for the Panthers, so that job was open. So C.J. Hance from Throckmorton to St. Joe, if you're a local football fan, you know the value of that for sure.
That's an interesting move, you know, leaving your hometown school to go to who has been very successful and going to, not that St. Joe's been bad, but they haven't put up the numbers that Throckmorton has. So that's an interesting move.
It's 1A Division 2 to 1A Division 1, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. So, you know, maybe the numbers certainly, you know, school numbers certainly probably right. Something to do with that. So best of luck, I guess, to Coach Hance and the Panthers. That's all I got for local stuff, guys. Anything else we're missing?
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay. Very, very good. Let's move on to regional stuff then. Mark Bindle's listening for this part of the show.
Oh, boy.
The Dallas Mavericks lost last night in a crazy ending. Ultimately, it was a half court and then some buzzer beater by Max Strus. But just the end of the game, I saw the highlights on SportsCenter. It was back and forth, a bunch of dagger threes each way. What are your thoughts? Do you see the clip of this?
We're gonna let you and Cutter discuss this one because Grant and I have both gotten Mark and Ben Coker back on our side. So you guys take it away.
We did have a meeting. Chad and I did have a meeting with Coker the other day. And
a meeting?
There was a meeting at the regional tournament. I'm not gonna say what happened, but one of two things was about to happen. Either we were going to get on the same page or we were about to have an Anchorman style fight, podcast to fake podcast in the
pitchforks.
Yeah. In the parking lot of the MPEC. Yeah. It was coming. And I'm just going to be honest. I was going to have to call you.
Yeah.
We almost got to a fighting point and I was going to have to call you and it smoothed itself out. So it's okay right now.
Look, there are some IP questions, intellectual property surrounding this podcast. So
I know.
We've got to put our foot down.
Oh, well, for sure. And here's the thing. Like, I think we established, I think you just send this clip out, that Mark Bindle is not our Jiminy Cricket. He is not let our conscience be our guide person. But, and that's the thing. I think Ben, the more that Chad and I talked to Ben the other day, I think Ben is just doing this to stir. I don't know what side Ben sits on, to be honest. I think he can be bought out. I think he can be bought over to the freebie side.
So you're just now realizing that Ben will do some things just to stir it up?
Correct. Well, again, I think Ben can be bought over to the freebies.
Here's the problem. Ben is such a lover of Luca. I don't know.
I get that.
I will say Ben and Bindle might be the most passionate Mavericks fans I personally know.
Yes. First of all, yeah, if we want to get into this, I'm about to go off.
Oh, boy. Okay. Here we go.
And it's not with the team. I think the team has actually made great strides lately. You know, Nico Harrison making some – pushing the right buttons, unlike Free. But – Jay Kidd, you know, and you know, Coach, you know, I don't come after coaches, but Jay Kidd ain't it.
Oh,
I mean, to see
Max take.
Oh yeah, hot sports opinion. To see Max Strus absolutely start catching fire, and then to not have the ability to just go, hey, let's take a tea. You go over there and you calm down for a minute and think about how hot you really are.
Mm-hmm.
He has the fingers on the pulse of that team, and he can control it. Yet he's the one who's like, well, you know, they got to figure it out. We'll have to figure it out. It makes my blood boil as a Mavs fan to know that sometimes we are going to be maybe a game or two away from either being in the playoffs or having to be in that play-in tournament where you don't want to be. And it all could have potentially been avoided by, you know, maybe taking a few timeouts or challenging a call when you had the chance to.
You know that that's the one thing that I would say I dislike. I will stand on my platform of game management for coaches because that's their job. But Yeah, we haven't had a J. Kidd conversation here. They've all been kind of centered around Luka, and that's what's gotten the other fake podcast all stirred up.
I think that J. Kidd can control some of Luka's – everybody who complains about Luka saying that he – so you say that he's too far out there and saying that, oh, he probably gets in too much trouble.
No, NBA says he's fat. So here's the thing. NBA says he's fat.
Okay, so here's the thing.
Yeah, that's right.
Here's the thing. As a coach, like you talk about game management, if you have a player that is his ability, or really any player, if you can step in as a coach and say, I got this, it's the same as a baseball manager, in my opinion, as a baseball manager coming in to argue balls and strikes for your star player. Okay? It's like, I've got you. You step away from this, I'll take care of this. You don't always have to take a tech for him, but I guarantee if you step up like that, A, he won't have as many, and he'll have the respect saying, my guy's got my back, I feel you. Now, but all
I agree with you, Cutter, on one thing is the sense. I'm sorry, I know I just interrupted you.
It's okay.
You mentioned, you know, sometimes just taking it for the team. I can't tell you how many quote unquote baseball arguments I had where the coach has come out there and said, look, man, I'm really not that upset, but I'm just looking to try to stir it up with my kids or to get my parents.
That's
you know, and like I say, a lot of times, and the one thing is normally they're honest and they'll tell you, and I'm sure it happens in basketball where a coach will go up to the referee and say, hey, man, I want you to team me up right here.
Exactly.
You know, or something, you know, just so it looks like you've got their back. And sometimes I don't know if you have to do that as much in the pros, but then again, I do think sometimes those players just want to know that you're standing behind them.
I've done it with 7-year-olds before. I've come to the referee and go like, look, you know, we're going to have to talk this over because my guys aren't feeling good. And so we have it out, you know.
Yeah.
So, again, I just feel like Jason Kidd is just – he wants to be a game manager or something, but he just wants to do it with his hands crossed over here, and he's cool and calm. And, you know, there is something to be said about a cool and calm on the sideline. That's great. But there are times when you got to step in there, and you know really got to put the fire out, or you've got to start the fire. And I just don't think
Jake needs to do it. He needs to do the fake water drop.
That was a smart play. I mean, it was gutsy, but smart. But, yeah, I don't think you could pull that off twice.
I don't think he pulled it off the first time.
Well, he got the desired result, but yeah, he kind of got grilled for it.
I will say this, and I think I've said this before. I am not just overly impressed with any of the coaches in the NBA. I feel like that is one of the places where coaching makes the least amount of difference. In the NBA head coaches, I feel like they make the least amount of difference in a game. And I just don't think there's very good ones right now. I just really don't.
I kind of agree with you. I think the style of play that the NBA is accustomed to right now has kind of taken some of the steam out of coaches, you know, because it's so appealing to average 120 a game. You just go, hey, go make a shot, right? You know, there's not a whole lot of play calls. It's just leave it up to the talent on the floor.
Yep.
But we all know that these things come in cycles too. And before you know it, we'll end up having another Detroit Pistons, you know, Ben Wallace-led type team who wins with defense.
Yeah,
and you'll have another great team on your hands. And again, you can still manage it in a way, but there are a few good head coaches or great head coaches, I think, in the NBA right now.
We're over 30 minutes into this podcast yet to have a Toby McDuff reference. He's a Pistons fan, so there you go. Toby McDuff.
Ding.
Hey, good job, Tobin.
He always sends this little gif of him
dancing with the stars.
Well, he is dancing.
Is it a gif or a gif?
It's a gif.
Sorry.
What is it?
I said gif, but they just corrected me.
Well, I say it's gif.
This is peanut butter.
Exactly. And it's also stands for graphic interface format or interlace format, whatever, but it's graphic, so it's G. It's graphic.
Okay.
Even though the guy who made it says it's GIF.
We're learning lots of things here. This show is educational.
Sure is.
If nothing else.
I really feel like you need to get the reins back on the show, sir.
MJ, grab the steering wheel.
Okay, here we go. All right. Max Strus's buzzer beater, second longest buzzer beater to win in regulation in the NBA, and they beat the Mavs on a just cash shot from beyond half court.
59 feet. Small fact real quick that I heard this morning.
Educational, good.
The third longest shot, also against the Mavericks, back in the 80s, Dr. J in Reunion Arena.
Huh. Yeah.
Really?
How about that?
It's like 55 feet.
Against the Reunion Rowdies.
Mm-hmm. They weren't rowdy that night.
Yeah.
Chad, spring training continues. Give us our weekly installment of what's going on in Surprise.
Here's what you need to know about spring training right now. it's pretty boring. Your starters aren't playing a whole lot. They're getting maybe one or two at-bats, although Marcus Semien did come up yesterday in his first at-bat against the Diamondbacks and did the same thing in his last at-bat that he did in his last at-bat last year against the Diamondbacks and hit a home run. But, you know, it's just about getting players ready. Hopefully nobody gets injured. You know, Evan Carter took a ball off the wrist the other day, ended up being x-rays were negative. I'll tell you what the surprising thing is right now with spring training. What are we, 2 weeks into spring training? They've just started games. And we've still got some studs who aren't signed.
Yeah, really?
Is there?
Yeah, I mean, you're talking Blake Snell, who won the NL Cy Young Award, hasn't been signed. Jordan Montgomery, who was the Rangers star, hasn't been signed. I can't think of any more right off the top of my head, but there's five or six guys that have yet to sign contracts for this year.
What do you think's holding that up, Chad? I mean, I know for Montgomery, you know, he's been shopping around. I think the last I heard, he had an offer, or at least the Red Sox were going to offer him.
Yeah.
But what's he waiting for?
Two words. Most of these people that haven't signed yet, Scott Boras.
Agent, yes.
There you go.
I think the thing with Montgomery, I think he isn't quite getting the number he's looking for yet. And they've talked a lot about these pillow contracts. Like Clay Bellinger just signed a 3-year contract with the Cubs with an opt-out every year. Basically, come in, if I do my job, I can opt out and I can make more money. Montgomery's 31 years old. I don't think he really wants to take that pillow contract. But then if he does take that pillow contract, I've read a lot of talk, he really wants to come back to the Rangers. Because if you're going to take that prove-it type of a deal, where would you want to go? Do you want to go to a team that you're already comfortable with, that you know is going to have success, and that you think you can have success? So I think that's where his stalemate is he's not getting the number he's wanting, but he's not low enough yet to get the Rangers back involved to a number that he's happy with yet.
Checks out. Yeah. Definitely checks out. But
he was the big lefty, right? Yeah. Remind
yes.
me. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I yes. like him. They bring traded, him back.
They traded for him at the All-Star – I mean, not the All-Star, at the trade deadline last year, and he came in and was – especially in the playoffs, was just – him and Evaldi were just
– Yeah, bring him back. Mine. I like Steady. Him. Bring him back.
I mean, yeah, do what you got to do as long as it's a number that you can deal with, you know?
Yeah, and that's the big thing for the Rangers this year, as I understand it, is they just don't have a lot of money to spend because they're kind of up in limbo with their whole, you know, cash to spend and their TV rights and contracts. And, and that's kind of been
wait, the – you mean Valley stinks?
Oh, my goodness.
And you start getting into luxury tax, I'd be lying if I said I knew exactly how it works, but for baseball purposes, it's kind of the unofficial salary cap, and I know there's different thresholds, and once you go over it, you have to pay, like, I think I read the other day, like, if they signed Jordan Montgomery to $20 million, for every dollar they spend, they would have to spend, like, $1.47 in taxes. So,
yeah.
Do the math on that, and I guess that's just a number and it's not just the Rangers. There's a lot of teams that don't want to get into that luxury tax area.
Can I go back to, wait, did we break news that Bally's stinks? I'm sorry, is that breaking news? Like,
nah.
Don't you broadcast for them?
I'm still waiting on my check, Bally's. Like, I'm still waiting on a couple of years ago payback.
I was letting him say it. Yeah.
Grant had the personal connection to Bally's.
Yeah, the bankruptcy letter. I'm still waiting on my money.
Send a past due invoice to
unbelievable.
Wow.
So long story short with that, you know, the Rangers ended up agreeing this year. And I think they ended up getting most of their money, but it's all up in the air after this year. And, of course, you know, the frustrating thing for fans is, yeah, the Rangers are getting their money, but Bally's is hard to watch. I mean, there's only a couple of providers that you can even watch Bally's on.
Well, they better get it in gold bars instead of don't take a check from Bally's. It will bounce.
They're going to offer you in Bitcoin?
Yeah, just if they'd offer me anything, I'd take it.
And maybe don't take an ownership stake because I'm pretty sure
that definitely don't take that. You'll be then in on the bankruptcy case. You'll be going to see the IRS.
Wow. Okay. Well, from Dallies. Baseball to the NHL real quick, I'd like to get my plug in here for the Dallas Stars. We talked last week about how they won 7 of 8. They've now lost 6 of 7.
What happened there?
That's a rough stretch, man.
Not good.
Jekyll and Hyde, man. That is the ultimate Jekyll and Hyde team.
It's not going to get you very far in the postseason when you lose 6 of 7 because series are only 4.
Well, you're not going to get to the postseason. You keep losing that many in a row.
They were leading the division, though.
Oh, so okay, never mind. Go Stars!
But they're probably not anymore. This was last week, so yeah.
Okay. You know what's funny, though, is, you know, you mentioned hockey and even basketball. I mean, it's kind of like baseball. I mean, now hockey and basketball aren't quite as long as seasons, but, you know, the one thing with these long seasons is you have hot stretches and cold stretches. I mean, MJ, you know, we were sitting here discussing the Rangers in September when they just got trounced by the Astros. Like, I want to say it was like 43-3 in a three-game series. And we thought, well, season's over, you know, because, you know, it's just, it's such a long season and so many hots and colds. You just hope you get hot at the right time.
That's the name of the game. You know, it's really a timing chasm more than it is anything
else. It's all about matchups when you get in the postseason.
Absolutely. Just get there. First and foremost, all about just get matchups. To the postseason and you'll try to figure it out.
I said chasm and you didn't react.
I know because now it's just our vernacular.
Okay. Anyway, Chris, are you ready for this?
It depends on what it is.
It's our segment. We're a big segment show.
Big segment show. I remember those.
Trademark segment. We're going to add a word this week. What the are we doing?
What are we doing? What are we doing?
What are we doing?
What are we doing?
We have a bleep
button.
Out.
I need that button all the time on me.
Why didn't I get to press it?
You could have. You want to try it again?
No.
Okay. Well, Chad, I know you're remote, but you're going to edit in that music later, right?
Yes, yes.
Thank you for doing that. We appreciate it.
And we do want to stake intellectual property to this because Ben Coker has tried to steal it for his fake podcast.
He tried to steal it?
Yep. WAWD, what are we doing? That belongs to us. Okay. So this week, last week, we talked about handshake lines.
Okay.
Grant Freeman had the take. Get rid of him. Let's go back to the way we did it in COVID. Wave across the gym.
You didn't clip that up. I was glad. Thank you. Yeah, I was glad you kind of just left that one out.
After this podcast, they might have to go in and delete our scheduled post then because it's actually in the queue.
It's sitting there.
Not the whole thing, but
no, it's fine. You can let it roll.
Anyway, sorry, I lost my train of thought because of that. We've talked about the handshake lines and all that. Well, this week it's post-game activities, but it's not necessarily the handshake.
Yeah.
It's court storming, right? So the whole national narrative this week has been court storming. What are we doing? Why are we allowing it? Now, let me set the scene first, right? So it happened in a Duke-Wake Forest game over the weekend, I believe it was, where this Duke stud, he's like a 7-footer, high draft pick, he just gets rushed by fans from Wake Forest after they make the upset win, and he dings up his knee a little bit, had to kind of get carried off the court by his teammates. And remember, just like a month ago, this happened to Caitlin Clark, the Iowa girl, women's basketball star, where she got like basically bundled by a fan, and she happened to be all right. But it starts this narrative about storming the court, and really it's kind of this tradition, this rite of passage, right, especially with basketball, and I guess more so becoming with college football too. But the narrative now is, why are we allowing it? If this is putting athletes and coaches in danger where they shouldn't be, they're in their court of play, then why do we allow it? So I guess let's go around the table. Chad, we're going to start with you. Your take on court storming and, you know, tying it into what happened this week.
My first thought is, how do you stop it? I mean, and that's a serious question, because technically, you know, and I'm sure they probably have it in basketball. In football, you're not supposed to rush the field after a win. And I think teams get fined when their fans do rush the field. So that goes back to, how do you stop it? I like it. I mean, you're talking about how many times have teams stormed, I mean, fans stormed the field, and how many injuries are we talking? I also think, you know, I'm going to be a little bit of a contrarian here, but, you know, I watched that video multiple times, and not to put the blame on the player fully, but he kind of looked like he initiated that contact a little bit.
I've seen the video twice. It's obviously from a wide angle, and like you said, obviously we don't want to put blame on anybody in particular, especially in their court of play. But it is, you know, he doesn't exactly have a chance to brace himself, so he's kind of
he's
reacting, I think, to seeing a swarm of people not worried about his safety.
It's not a good thing, and I don't, like I say, the fans need to realize that it's not their court, and if they are going to rush the court, I mean, put your phone down and not be looking down and look up and see, you know, it's not that hard to run around a player. I know in football, just because I saw it firsthand this year for the first time ever, the security staff knew it was happening, and they made a little Congo line, if you will, to allow Oklahoma's players to get off the field and to keep fans out of their way to allow them to get off the field. Now, can you do that? I don't know that you can do that with basketball. I guess you could to an extent, but I just go back to how do you truly stop it from happening?
Chris, I'm going to take the last on this.
You're going to take the last one? Well, MJ, do you want to go? I mean,
no, go right ahead.
All right. Well, how do you stop it from happening? Well, first of all, let me just give you my opinion. I think court storming is overdone now. I just think there's too many instances of like, well, let's do it because everybody's doing it. And it kind of lost its sachet, at least in my time. Old man here shaking my fist at a cloud. It used to be reserved for beating the number one team in the country or something like
it
that.
It is so, overdone, that is for sure.
So, yeah, so that's my opinion, and that's all it's worth. It's just an opinion. However, how do you stop it? My thought is you either completely, like, go – cops on it and say, I mean, we are going to fine you. I mean, not just like the school. I'm talking about the kid, the fan. We're going to catch you as many as possible and start locking you up. I mean, make it a crime. Or, and I'm totally switching to the side here, embrace it and say, guys, if y'all storm the court, you have to wait. Like, literally make it part of, this is the tradition. If we're going to beat this team and y'all storm the court, then you have to wait until after the opposing team is gone. Okay, like, I mean, that way it's just like, guys, well, we know you want to, and we're going to let you, but you got to let them get off the court. And then you can go party as much as you want. And that way we eliminate all this, like, either bad feeling or this or that or the other. Then all the kids can come out and storm the court and all that jazz. It's got to be one or the other, in my opinion, but you just take which one you want.
All right, Grant,
I'm for sure out on it for both reasons. One, as a coach, and two, as an administrator. Number one rule is, as a coach, is I'm supposed to take care of and protect my kids on the court. As an administrator running an event, I'm supposed to protect the people who are on the court competing from the people who are have purchased a ticket and they're in the stands. This started a couple of years ago, and it started to gain traction, and people start doing it, and you're right. So what happens now? How did we eliminate or try to eliminate people running onto the field, streaking, or doing things like that? We arrest them. We put them in jail. Mm-hmm. Okay. We actually had the debate. We just had the debate on this podcast of whether the person who was competing on the field, who's supposed to be on the court, initiated contact with somebody who's not supposed to be on the court. We had that conversation on this podcast just a few minutes ago.
Just about 9 seconds.
That's ridiculous. That is unbelievably ridiculous. They are not supposed to be there. That person is supposed to be there. And correct. We talked about who was at fault there. For creating or initiating contact, that's where we're wrong. We have totally gone wrong on this. And so I actually listened to Bill Simmons' podcast coming over here, and they actually talked about this specific subject. This used to be a thing in the NBA. Court storming used to be a thing in the NBA, and they started whenever people would run on the floor. This is how they got it stopped. They detained them and arrested and fined them all individually.
Yeah.
Those kids don't care about the school getting fined. It's not like it's affecting their pocket. And so they started arresting people and detaining them and fining them or citing them and making them pay if they did it, and it stopped. You don't see the courts being stormed ever in an NBA game. That started in the mid-80s. And I just think, again, safety of the players on the field, the or the court, the safety of the people who are supposed to be on the court or field of play is of utmost paramount. And the second part then is that's a whole reason why you have stands and you have the field of play.
Absolutely. And, I mean, just one other thing to add to that is in college athletics, where we're seeing this really happen,
mm-hmm.
Who's at the sidelines? Football, basketball? It's all students.
Yeah, because
they
put
all
the
basically didn't pay anything
there.
For their ticket.
Correct.
They're out there to have a riot. I mean, they're there for a good time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, NBA, who's sitting courtside?
Millionaires.
You know, yeah, millionaires, yeah. Stars, everything. We don't need that mess.
Yeah.
And so it's just a matter of, I just think we just have to know it. Again, if you want to do it, embrace it. But you have to, like I said, as an administrator, protect those involved, and then go out and have a party. Yep. But otherwise,
don't have it on the floor.
Yeah.
Or the field.
So I'm going to provide a little bit of context to a little bit of that everybody's said. Number one, Chad first said it. How do you stop it? Well, I'm going to give you what two people said nationally. Alabama athletic director, he says, if you storm the court, we reverse the outcome. You lose the game.
Ooh.
Okay? Jay Billis, ESPN, former player, coach, not coach, but player. He says, do what you say, Grant. Arrest him. Right? You let everybody on the court, fine. You can't stop them when they run out like that. But you can't. You can let them not get off, right? You just circle the court and say, everybody here is detained. Mm-hmm. You will be receiving a written citation, and that'll stop it real quick. So those are two, you know, quote unquote famous people with their opinions.
Well, Jay's a practicing lawyer, so he would know legally that you can do that.
He like, is? I did not know he was a practicing lawyer.
Put it on the back of the ticket.
Him and Mike Leach.
There you go. Okay, interesting. Anyway, sorry, lost my train of thought again. It must be Chad being gone that makes me all over the place today. And then, Chris, I think you bring up a good point, too. It's like, you know, what is the demographic that is doing this, right?
Absolutely.
And it's college students. So maybe do you have to block off the seating in a certain way that even prevents them from
rushing.
Where
they can't get there, yeah.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? Because, I mean, like, the moms and dads in the stands aren't the ones rushing down on the field.
No, they're not.
Or the court.
Although Chad Johnson would have at Oklahoma State this year if he could have made it down. I guarantee he would have.
If you give Chad good seats anywhere, he's rushing.
Chad would have broken a leg trying to climb over the blue stand.
Going back to the part about fines, too, I was reading about this. Apparently most conferences do have some sort of fine system in place. I guess the ACC is a little loosey-goosey where historically they just say, we're not going to do it. And part of the reason that is these universities like that stuff, right? Like you get pictures and video that you know, maybe you put it up in your locker room. Like it's a recruiting tool. Like look what we – like this is stuff they want to happen. So they're kind of, I guess – slacking purposely when it comes to the fines.
Then they need to shut up whenever they start crying because one of theirs, if they compete in that conference and it's okay in that conference, yep. Then shut up when you get it done to you and something bad happens.
Sure. I think he just directed that to a specific university.
Can I walk back just a little bit what I said a while ago?
Uh-oh.
No, not allowed. We do not walk back opinions on this show.
And I'm going to stay with the I love the court rushing. I love the field rushing. That's just part of what college sports is. And when I said it looked like the player was maybe initiating contact, he's probably bracing himself. I don't know what's happening there, and he shouldn't have to protect himself.
Correct.
So I didn't want to make it. I don't want to make it sound like the player was at fault. The player was never at fault. I do think maybe the player could have done something to avoid it. But then we get into the discussion: why should the player have to do anything to avoid it?
It's the analogy, I think, of what we're going at. Like you said, if you're going to jump into this arena, remember, it's okay for them to hit you back. You know, it's very
right.
WWE somebody fans jumping into the ring or
– Yeah, somebody rush Dan truck. Campbell. I'd love to see that.
Oh, man.
Somebody rush the field and go attack Dan Campbell. I'd love to see that.
Yeah, he's going
to – Well, y'all remember a few years ago, I want to say it was Oregon maybe, that they rushed the field and the fans started messing with one of the Oregon players, and the Oregon player decked him.
Nice. Yes.
Nice.
That's what you get.
In one other potential solution I read on social media yesterday when I was doing some research, Chris, this goes along with what you said. If you're going to embrace it and let kids do it, okay, 30-second shot clock that starts as soon as the buzzer sounds, as soon as that gives 30 seconds for the other team to get the heck out of the way.
Right. So I'm saying you can embrace it. You can kind of put together a system for that. You know, every one of us knows that as soon as the buzzer goes off, where do the officials go?
See ya.
It's a smoke cloud, and they're gone.
Same reason Grant doesn't like the handshake.
There you go.
Yeah, I agree.
And so it's just a matter of if you want to do it, I'm all for it. And like you said, it does have a tool. It's fun, and it's photogenic, and it's college life, right? But you just have to structure it in a way that it can be done in a safe way.
So this is now now this has happened. It's got us to this point. What happens when somebody takes a weapon down there? What happens?
Yes.
What happens again? Mass hysteria like this. Watch the Woodstock 99 documentary. Mm-hmm. Like watch things where mass mob stuff in a place that they're not supposed to be.
Uncontrollable.
It's not good, people, guys. Yeah. We should not celebrate something that is not supposed to happen. That is just not. I don't see any good coming from this outcome.
Not to mention the adult beverages that are usually flowing at games like this.
Which has now been – the NCAA has allowed that to happen.
Yeah, it's really come into prominence. So I agree with you. That would just be tragedy anywhere. But no, it's – you're right. It's the X factor of just a large group of people massed together in kind of a bit of hysteria. So it's absolutely – it could be scary.
So the What Are We Doing, in a nutshell, is about court storming and whether or not it should continue. So we'll see where the NCAA goes from this. We know they're a governing body, but sometimes they don't govern all too well. So who knows what's going to happen.
Oh, yeah, kind of laying the ballys till the NCAA sucks, too. So
Grant is hot.
Go Ooh. Ahead. NCAA, the greatest suck in the world.
If anybody from Bally Sports is listening and looking to get their legal team involved, it is gfreeman@wfisd.net.
Yeah, go ahead and send it.
So, okay.
Just send me some money, maybe a cash app payment too.
Yeah, you'll get a countersuit coming right back at you, bud.
Slapping it right on.
Countersuit coming right back at you.
All right, we're coming up on an hour, so let's wrap this thing up here. As we usually like to end with, a random thought of the week. Nothing random about this one. But personal experience, I hate the dentist, man. I had to go to the dentist this week. Is there anything worse than the dentist?
Yes, there is, but I don't really want to get into that.
Like Bally's.
Yeah. The dentist, not a lot of fun.
Hate the
there
dentist.
Are things that are worse. There I will say
doctors,
that.
Yeah, going to the dentist, man, that's like pulling teeth.
Oh, wait. I don't do this.
No, that's not it.
No, that's not it. We need the
I should have bleeped him out.
Wrong drums.
What do you mean by that?
Oh.
Chad, say that again.
That's like cool and cheap.
What do you mean by that?
That's awesome. This whole button thing is great.
So far off the rails.
Yeah. Should push all of them before we get out of here.
I don't know. Yeah.
Here's my beef, right?
Yeah.
So I go to the dentist and, you know, cleaning and getting a filling or two fixed. By the way, that's something I learned too. I had cavities as a kid. Do you know fillings aren't permanent? You got to get like fillings filled. Like what? Thought that was like permanent.
And that's when he said, "What do you mean by that?"
There you go. Yeah. Exactly. Anyway, so this is what I'm moaning about. I go and I sit in a chair for 2.5-3 hours. I pay you multiple hundred dollars, and you get to just annihilate my teeth with drills and picks and all this
Listen.
Crap.
I tell you what, I'm going to fix this problem for you.
You know a dentist, don't you?
Yeah, I do. I do. My dentist, Dr. Hyan, awesome. Okay, but I do know this. I'm going to fix your problem. Okay. You pay hundreds of dollars for this? Just pay me $100 and I'll drill your teeth.
No thanks.
Well, you got to go do it anyways. Like,
at least give me some Novocaine.
Well, I don't have that, but I'll give you, like, I'll knock you out.
With your fist?
Yeah. You won't feel it. And then I'll only charge you $100.
I'm time outing, by the way. My dentist, she's an awesome lady. It is not personal. Okay. It is her profession that I hate.
So to bring up a Seinfeld quote, you're an anti-dentite. You don't an like dentists.
Yeah,
correct.
Right.
I am an anti-dentite.
Oh, my goodness. No, I feel you. I think all of us really deep down feel somewhat the same because it's very, like you said, here they are. I'm paying for the right for you to murder me almost and
stick things in my
what
mouth.
What dentist do you guys go to?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. What in the world is going on at your dentist?
What's going on at yours?
Let me just give you an idea though. I remember it was in high school going to the dentist and they had the TVs. That was one of the new things back in the day, having a TV up. And it was playing WGN and the Cubs were playing middle of the day. And I just remember my dentist like in there drilling, like you said, you know, doing a filling or whatever. And then you hear the crack of the bat and then he would rip that thing out. Back at the TV, and I'm going, what are you doing, man?
Now, here's the deal. I don't know how you – I don't know your eating habits. I know this guy's eating habits, and I know why he should be – yeah, I know why he should be at the dentist a lot, and he has a lot of cavities. I don't know what yours are, but apparently Chad and I eat very well.
It's the coffee.
But we're not worried.
The coffee does it, yeah.
Okay. I wouldn't say I eat very well, but
– I almost brought you some little dentists.
I have a question. Hey, so back to MJ's eating habits. He was late today. Did he bring any munchkins with him?
No.
Wait a minute. Was I late? Check the cameras. It was not 10.
Yeah, we did start directly on time.
Oh, okay.
We started directly on time. You called in very early. So you are having to set up this board that I get to play with, but
okay.
Yeah, that's I do have because Chris is here and because you know we want to be unique to our first guest. Like, have you ever listened to Chris and I discuss Little Debbie? Like, where do you sit on Little Debbie snacks
and Halloween?
Are you
candy.
For them or against them?
Before I answer that, are you about to tell me that you eat Little Debbie's? Chris
me?
Does.
Oh,
What part of our relationship do you think that I eat little
well,
Debbie's?
Well, that's what I was just about to be mind blown yeah, based saying. On your eating habits.
We have seriously
may or may not have gained a lot of weight based on little Debbie, or as we were calling them, large Deborah snacks.
Okay, so what is yours? So what is yours, Chad? Like, I'm guessing, MJ, you're for little Debbie's. Like, what is your go-to little Debbie?
Are the Nutty Buddies little Debbie?
Yes.
Nutty Buddy.
Okay, well, MJ?
My answer was going to be I don't frequently eat them. Like, okay. I don't buy them, like the zebra cakes or anything necessarily. Okay. But yeah. I will eat if it's in front of me, yes.
Okay, this guy's like Super Bowl every year. This guy to my left, his Super Bowl every year is what?
This body is built by Deborah. Yeah. But, the Christmas tree cakes. This is a point of contention between he and I.
Okay.
And I was going to bring, even though I don't, it's not in season, yeah. I was going to bring a cake today and I totally forgot about it because I wanted to make a bet and be like, you know, either I eat maybe a salad or you eat this.
Yeah.
You know, I just feel like he would shut down. The
My whole body would shut down if I ate. So, yeah. Again.
We did the math on calories.
Chris did our.
I've seen him yeah. like 2 months ago on our podcast. Right. A couple weeks ago.
Exactly. I almost died. Like, I did. I ate, what is it, one? I ate one, almost passed out. But, again, like, I go back to Chris and I have had a long-running debate, like a seven-year debate on the pregame show for Coyote football about Little Debbie's. And he is convinced that the Christmas tree cakes are totally different than the generic normal zebra cake, which is the same exact thing, just made up like a Christmas tree.
No.
And he's convinced that they're like this gold. Like, Christmas tree cakes are like this gold. And so, again, like last year, I guess 2 years ago in the 23 season when we made the run of the state quarterfinals, he would bring me, as we got into the playoffs, a Christmas tree cake down on the field, like before the game. And again, I don't eat them. So, like, it would go in my pocket. It would go in my pocket.
I stormed the court and gave you.
Yeah, it would go in my pocket, and then he would ask me about it afterwards. I was like, well, think about this. I went through a whole game with this, and then after a playoff win, they would dump water on me. So at no point was I going to eat that anyways at that point. So
why? It's still good.
Little Debbie. So you don't have a favorite?
Not particularly, no.
Like, there's not a go-to for you? Like, oatmeal cream pies, like the cake?
No, probably a zebra cake, but...
But a zebra cake, not a Christmas tree cake.
I've never had the Christmas one specifically, no. The look on Chris's face right now.
I know what to get MJ.
I mean, so I asked him this year, we actually had this conversation. I asked him the day, like the weekend they came out, I said, how many do you have on you? And he said, and I quote, how many do I have on me? I've already eaten two boxes today. Two boxes.
Oh my gosh.
That was at 10 a.m. when we taped the pregame show. 10 a.m. he had eaten two boxes. There are six cakes per box.
I think
five. Chris, you're not a big guy.
Yeah. Six cakes per box at about 800 calories per cake. He had eaten at least 12 by 10 o'clock.
Are you shaming his diet?
He is. He always has.
I don't know how he does it. I cannot get up. Like,
he's still here in the flesh.
Exactly. I know. I can't. I'm shocked. I'm just... It is.
I don't have blood. I just have syrup.
This has been an 8 year conversation that has blown my mind. That since you were on the Free For All podcast today, I had to bring up.
And I really blew his mind too. Over the last few years, they introduced the mega trees.
Yeah, like the double ones.
They're like two times the size of a regular cake, and I'm like, oh yeah, I'll eat those too. A whole box on you.
It's horrible.
I have a problem with stopping. I'm kind of like the Pringles. Once I pop, I can't stop. And it's like, once I open that box, like, let's go.
I can't. Again, and we were complaining about the dentist.
Episode 17 of the Free For All brought to you by Macaulay Landscape and Little Debbie's.
No, Christmas tree cakes.
I'll be back next week if that's the case. Yeah.
If we got a sponsorship from Little Debbie's, we'd never get him out of here. He would just be here.
I'm going to go make my own podcast and just have Little Debbie's, just Little Debbie talk.
There you go. So we've now got three podcasts. We've got ours, the fake one with Bindle, and
that's
and
not...
Ben.
The fake Ben Coker and Mark Bindle podcast is not associated with this podcast.
It's a rival, according to Ben. I'd love to see the ratings.
In his own world.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Well, Chris Cutter, this was really fun, man.
Yeah.
Thanks, MJ. Absolutely. It's been a blast.
The first guest on the Free For All podcast. It took us 4 months to get
number one.
And also, Chad phoning in was also, I wouldn't call it fun, but it was unique. It was the first time it has happened.
Yeah, Chad.
It was an experience.
Was it seamless on your end?
Yeah. Now I just have to figure out how to edit it all when I get back on Friday.
Yeah, that's going to be a
It was
a
seamless task. On our on his end because he couldn't see us.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Yeah.
Let's just hope today is Wednesday when we record. Let's just hope when I'm back in the office on Friday that Grant Freeman has not lost the SD card.
Oh, what's that?
That, you know what, Chris, the SD card may be better in our hands than his.
Yeah, probably.
Especially, is it a micro SD, Chad?
Micro SD and the regular SD.
Oh, is that that box you gave me to bring over here?
That box.
Yes.
Did you even plug it in? Are we even recording?
I don't know. I brought it.
Where's Coach D? I was going to say, hopefully Coach Davenport hooked us up here at the WFISD Education Center. All right, that is going to do it for episode 17 of the Free4All. Kind of under the radar. We've been doing this thing for 4 months now, so that's pretty cool. We finally
We're not under the radar anymore.
No, definitely not. Definitely not. Our social media channel was a little quiet this week. I will admit, that falls on me. I was... You know, as Chris knows, we're driving around crazy this time of year. So we'll get that stepped up this week and get back to posting a lot of these clips from our show. We really appreciate you listening. If you're watching on YouTube, throw us a subscribe. If you could like the video, give it a little thumbs up. Maybe leave a comment. We'd appreciate that. If you're on Spotify, you can subscribe to the podcast. You can also rate us 1 to 5 stars. We'd appreciate a 5-star review. You can get notifications when the podcast release, auto downloads, all that good stuff. And of course, interact with us on social media. You can do it when we post on Facebook through the WFISD Athletics Facebook page that Chad runs, or on our Twitter account. Yes, it's now known as X, at Free4All WFISD. Thanks for bearing with us this week. Chad on the road at a conference, not in South Padre though. And then three of us here. Chris Cutter, our first guest here on the Free4All. We appreciate you stopping in and helping fill the void. Yeah, it was a great job. So.
Thank you very much. Chad, come back soon.
We'll end on that. Take care, guys, and thanks for listening. We'll see you next week on The Free4All.